Form is empty, emptiness is form, emptiness is not other than form, form also as not by the maintenance. In the same way, my filiating or recognition of constitutional factors and consciousness are empty. Shariputra, like this, all phenomena are emptiness, and having no characteristics, they are immortal and unceasing. They are not impure or pure, and they neither decrease nor increase. Therefore, Shariputra, in emptiness there is no form, no feeling, no recognition, no compositional factors, no consciousness, no eye, no ear, no nose, no tongue, no body, no mind, no appearance, no sound, no smell, no taste, no sensation, no phenomena. There is no quality of sight and so on until no quality of mind and no quality of mental consciousness. There is no ignorance and no exhaustion of ignorance, and so on up to no old age and death, and no exhaustion of old age and death. In the same way, there is no suffering, no origin, no ending, and no path, no wisdom, and no attainment, and no non-attainment. Therefore, Shariputra, since there is no attainment, bodhisattvas rely on and abide by means of the profound perfection of wisdom. And since the minds have no aspirations, they have no fear. Transcending falsity, they attain nirvana. All the Buddhas who dwell in the three times have relied upon the perfection of wisdom and have become true and complete Buddhas of unsurpassable, perfect, and complete enlightenment. Therefore, the mantra of the profound perfection of wisdom, the mantra of insight, the unsurpassed mantra, the unequaled mantra, the mantra which calms all suffering should be known as truth, for it is not deceptive. The mantra of the perfection of wisdom is proclaimed. Shariputra, this is how a bodhisattva mahasattva should train in the profound perfection of wisdom. Then the blessed one arose from that samadhi and said to the bodhisattva mahasattva, know the well of the Jeshara that he had spoken well. Well done, O son of the lineage, it is so. O son of the lineage, since it is just so, profound perfection of wisdom she practices just as you were taught, and the Tathagata is also rejoiced. When the Blessed One had said this, the Venerable Shariputra and Noble Avalokiteshvara Bodhisattva Mahasattva, and the entire gathering, as well as worldly beings, gods, humans, asuras, and avatars, rejoiced and praised the words of the Blessed One.
Namo Jesu Jambe Yama Chasebo Kami Lodu Dhiti Trinkel Nidha Nama Rapsewe Jini Nungu Jijin Zinchi Yini Tuka Lekwamsi Kanda Sibi Sura Mari
Shariputra, Rinpoche, 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 Rinpoche,
Abong Rinpoche. My Lord Rinpoche, the Chenmo Yabumba, Gilmai Chenmo Ma, Lumai Kama, Metoma Duguma, Masema Jijama, Yima Dawa Rinpoche,
Jaya Yom Yom Chodjilu Dutta So, according to the Lam Rim Teachings, prior to giving actual teachings of the Lam Rim, we have a tradition of reciting some chantings, such as supplication to the lineage gurus and so forth. So those are all done, it's meditatively, in other words, it's a very relaxingly, with a soothing melody. So it is not just we are making the sound soothing, but rather it is to really to cultivate one's pure motivations, so that that according to the history of the Lam Rim teachings, it says during this subjugation to the lineage gurus, some disciples had even gained a certain levels of realizations and accumulated tremendous amount of merits and virtues by engaging in such a recitation.
아니 소속이 돼서 되냐라 지속보다 생각한 걸 해서 봐 가지고 아 괜찮아 지금 수준은 너무 그래 아 괜찮아
So at this particular time, let's relax both our mind and body. In other words, relax bodily and mentally. It is not necessary that you can sit in a cross-legged position. If you're physically challenged and you're not able to do that, whatever that makes comfortable for you, you can be in that particular position, which makes you comfortable. So again, if you put a force and try to, you know, sit in a cross-legged positions, and if you're physically challenged, then your all attention will be focus on your particular part of your body that is, you know, painful. So therefore, we are wasting, you know, we're not being able to relax our mind at the same time. So try to be whatever that makes you comfortable in the position, in terms of your position. So what we really need is either individually or society, in the individual level or the societal level or the globe, in other words, at large. What we need is we really need a peace of mind. That is the key factor. That is the question that without any doubt, everyone needs peace of mind. So it is also worthwhile that I have participated in this Dharma teachings today, though I have not really understood the teachings of the Dharma. I really able to relax my mind. So it is worthwhile. Even though you are unable to understand what the teachings that have been taught by the teacher, if you're able to relax your body and mind at the same time, it is worthwhile. So then, of course, suddenly it is wonderful that if you are not only that you are able to relax your mind and body, but also you're able to understand the teachings, whatever the teachings that have been taught by the teacher, completely and unmistakably, then it's wonderful. What we are doing, you know, being here, gathering here, and taking our time and putting our efforts and energies, is to, from one hand, we are trying to dispel unknowing mind, in other words, try to dispel ignorance, in other words, and ignorance. Having dispelled one's ignorance, then one is actually learning something. It is through learning one is able to, you know, overcome one's ignorance. And on that basis, what we are really accomplishing here is we are accomplishing lasting happiness, which is desired by entire sentient beings. So, it's such a great purpose that we are accomplishing. So it is worthwhile to be participating in these teachings. So with this relaxing mind, with a very delightful mind, let's take our time to meditate, by visualizing Buddha Shakyamuni at the level of one's forehead, and try to place your try to place your mind on the image of the Buddha Shakyamuni.
So, we can't do it. 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 We can't
So, what is important, the most important when we are doing meditation here is, you know, try to not let your mind, overpowered by the mental excitement and laxity. So that is the main focus that we are. It is, again, you know, you don't really have to maintain your single-pointedness. If it is possible for you to maintain your single-pointedness by placing your mind upon the Buddha's image, that is wonderful. But if it's not, then you don't really have to do. But try your best to not to let your mind go elsewhere. In other words, outside. Having meditated on the Buddha, image of Buddha Shakyamuni, so as a result, imagine that Buddha is actually looking up on us very delightfully. With this, still maintaining this kind of visualization, we will recite the mantras of Buddha Shakyamuni. So, this mantra recitation is primarily focused on the dedication towards the Chenrabuji had been passed away to Nirvana a week ago. So let's take our time and take this opportunity to recite mantras to dedicate towards Chenrabuji. So Chodin Rinpoche, to share a little bit about Chodin Rinpoche, is a great practitioner as well as scholar. Someone who accomplished great levels of realizations, great scholar, great practitioner. Srimuchi used to recite the root of Manjushri root texts in Sanskrit. He was a few, you know, scholars who were able to actually read this, recite the root text of Manjushri in Sanskrit. So it's for my same monastery for myself. Though I haven't been able to have the opportunity to have a spiritual connection, but I know him very well. So this dedication, while doing such dedication, we have to have a different set of mind in the prayers. Not just like, you know, when we pray for someone who passed away and then we pray for having a better rebirth. So we normally do this kind of dedication for someone who passed away. But for them, we didn't really have to ask for a better rebirth. But what we have to do is we have to, you know, think about and focus on, dedicate on having an authentic rebirth, his reincarnation, who is able to fulfill the legacy of his past life, such as upholding the doctrines of the Buddha, propagation of the doctrines of the Buddha, and the preservations of the doctrines of the Buddha. While maintaining the positive motivations, the teaching that we are receiving is the great deities on the stages of the path to enlightenment, which is the teacher who shows us a path to the state of enlightenment. We are in the industry of preparing ourselves to gain omniscient, the state of omniscient mind, which is whatever the teachings that we are receiving, whatever the practice that we are doing, we are almost like in certain industry that preparing for accomplish something. So when you look at the thinking about the computer, the functions of the computer, it is something that is almost unbelievable. It's inconceivable, you know, what the computer can do nowadays. It does everything. You know, it can accomplish a great amount of work that actually requires hundreds of people, but can be done within 5 minutes, even 5 seconds. This is something great, immaculate, you know, phenomena that we have found as a human being. But if you really sharpen our wisdom, our mind, and our mind will even much more better than the computer.
Computer やるって、やるわけにもよんごろ、けんのがそんでるわ。ててんせて、ててんせて、けらしぶちぎどろ。ててんせて、けらちもやな。てて、どんぼぱべねん。
So in the case of computer, you know, there needs to be someone who can actually install all the programs inside the computer. Because in the beginning, the computer, actually physical, you know, structure of the computer alone cannot do anything. There needs someone, it requires a human being who can actually store the programs, download the programs, or to you know, install the programs inside the computer. Similarly, in our Buddhist tradition, we have the great masters of the treasure discovery. The treasure discoverer, the masters, again, the treasure must be hidden somewhere, and then when the time goes, and when it becomes appropriate time, then there will be another master who can actually discover the treasure. But when it comes to the development of our own mind, we don't really need someone that can store, or someone who can actually download or the install that within us. But this immaculate treasure or the jewel that we have within us need to be developed. We don't have to go elsewhere, but we have within us it's a very precious jewel that we have within us, which is the nature of our mind, the luminosity, the luminous nature of one's mind. So here again, we can't really discover the treasure within us simply. We would like to. That's not going to happen. So we have to look for it. We have to search, because that the wonderful treasure or the jewel that we have within us is actually, you know, covered by the layers and layers of trash, in other words, which are the delusions. So we need to peel off the layers of all this, you know. Delusions, and it is only through the peeling of the delusions will then enables one to, you know, discover the treasure that is within us. Some of you may have found out, you know, is there any phenomena called the nature of mind, so-called luminous, or the luminosity? Is it really covered by the advantageous delusions? So we might have a doubt about it, you know, how it could be. Is that real? And so forth. So if we imagine that ourselves, you know, all of us gather and then ask a question to each other about this, nature of our mind, which is untainted by the delusions, the mind, the clear nature of our mind. And if we were to engage in discussions, and what kind of answers we may have? What kind of answers that we will have? For instance, if I say you have a precious jewel, but you are unable to find that because it is completely covered by the dirt. And what kind of answer that you may have? So then, yes, it is completely difficult answer to it. Because the most probably the answer might, there might be an answer by saying that I don't believe in it. This would be the answer probably. Because it is not easy. If you really go through critical analysis of finding this clear mind for the nature of our mind, it becomes unfindable. So, we had, from more than 2,500 years ago, at the time of Buddha, till once on root guru, the instructions, unbroken instructions, had been carried out, transmitted from one to another, another master, by saying is by, you know, conveying the same message of having a precious jewel within all of us. But if we really try to practice diligently, appropriately, then there is a jewel that can be discovered within oneself.
So here,
you know, if we're able to find this, you know, the hidden treasure within us, then you're able to dispel our ignorance. So then there's nothing is obstructed, there's no obstacles for your knowledge. You'll be able to understand everything, entire spectrum of phenomena. So you will be free from any difficulties, in other words, you know, sufferings. Because most of the difficulties and sufferings that we come across, we encounter, is because of unknowing and not knowing. So long as you're able to dispel your, you know, ignorance, then you become knowledgeable. And not only just you know a certain part of subject or the objects and so forth, but you will be able to know entire spectrum of phenomena. This certainly will, you know, dispel the entire difficulties or the sufferings. So, we as ordinary beings, we are unable to discover or perceive what we call the subtle nature of ultimate, subtle nature of the mode of existence of the subtle nature. In other words, the ultimate nature of subtle ultimate nature. In that, we ordinary beings are like a blind person who is unable to see. And Arya, the superior beings, who possess eyes, who possess eyes to see those ultimate nature of reality. And so the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, who can see clearly, everything see very clearly, can guide us, someone who is completely blind, like ourselves.
Tendriye nilu thongye ye mi dan denbi ye ni jibu tamba nanji ye ni nilu ma thongye ma son la ten shang ye de la ni shang chu lang jire ba ta la ko su ba ba tok ma no ten shang chu lang ye no bu ten ye la ten de la ten ze shu
so ta. So then for us who are unable to see the mode of existence of, in other words, the ultimate nature of reality, was completely blinded by ignorance, unable to see the ultimate nature of reality, is then guided by the Buddhists and Bodhisattvas who possess the eyes to show us ultimate nature of reality. And a skillful or the method in which that really show us to see the ultimate nature of reality is the one, the subject that we are going through right now, which is the great treatise on the stages of the path to enlightenment. So then, for this kind of studies, to understand the ultimate nature of reality, it is not just adequate or sufficient enough. It's just enough to study and sharpen one's intellect, but rather one need to have a special set of motivations to really to embark upon the spiritual path. So therefore, what is really required is, it requires a teacher who teaches us unmistakably, and in other words, an authentic teacher who can really show us or guide us through the path. Because we are trying to study and learn ourselves, and try to engage in the practice and the skillful means or the methods. So in order to do that, we need to know. In order to know that, we need to rely on a teacher who could really teach us. So then, we're not going to go through this the outlines today, but the fourth outline, which is Dambanguji Loma Chitaturipa, which means the sequence in which the disciples are to be taught the actual instructions. And so, according to the teachings of the Lam Rim tradition, in other words, not only this Lam Rim, but a lot of, you know, the Lam Rim teachings in the different orders of, you know, for different major orders of the Tibetan Buddhism, the teacher would teach one part in the beginning, a little part, the one chapter or the one outlines, and then let the students actually practice and meditate upon. And once they're able to complete their meditations and able to gain certain levels of understanding and realizations, then the teacher will actually test his or her student and then move on to the next level. This is what traditionally done, but we are unable to do this.
So
we're almost at the end of explanation of law of cause and effect. So the previous lady which has gone through this outlines of the numbers of work to which she had said that I don't have to go through all this in English. So the particular chapter that we have, we're focusing right now, is developing the faith of conviction, that is the conviction, in other words, conviction in law of causality, which is the root of all temporary happiness and certain goodness. And then this has three subdivisions. The first reflection upon the law of causality in general, reflection upon law of causality in particular, and having reflected upon both those two, then how one can actually engage in the positive deeds and abandon the negative deeds. At this particular time that we have reached at the point of the way of purification through four powers. In particular, the way of purification through the four powers. It's on page 251, the last paragraph.
过去我现在提的，他说，当年年老老王那些，甚至让些有些话，他那查巴就对的，那查巴的出国，对吧？查巴的肯定出国的，是老有的，那到底怎样过呢？是吧？查巴他不接受，是吧？过去我先说呢，我做多了查巴就说那出国了。So,
if I go through this, lucidly, I spoke to about earlier that our mind is completely covered by the layers of the darkness, layers of ignorance. So we need to wash this, right? We need to clean this. Because if one's clothes is dirty, then we need to clean the clothes. We need to make sure that your clothes is actually free from dirt. So that in the same manner, in order to activate our luminous mind, we need to clean that the layers of those dirt. So we could also ask a question. What will happen to you tomorrow? So we don't know, nobody knows. None of us would actually say what exactly would happen to us tomorrow. That doesn't mean that tomorrow does not exist. Why we are not knowing that? Why we are really unknown of what's going to happen to us tomorrow.
ane me shipa de on ye chu lyu na me shipa de se ta kan de che bu de se lo yu di ta kan je ye le mi kan ta bu de ta ba de wa de ji
so then why we do not know what's going to happen to us tomorrow it's not that tomorrow or whatever that happens whatever that is going to happen to us tomorrow does not exist But rather, we are not knowing that. What we need to do here is to now, we need to clear that obstructs us, the obstacles which prevents us to know about tomorrow.
radio le chi yao yena kol ju ye chi ba yero ang ne chen ro ya bo chi na ro sa ya go na kang ga lo ge se chi ju ngro
so if we really come to understand come to you know proper understanding of what is meant by this luminous mind nature of one's mind then suddenly we all would like to really to discover that mind that nature of the nature of mind
ti ji yo ba de na so la ji sen ji ra ji yo se yo se de mi shi ba se to yo ba de ma so kan re ha ko re wa pe na na so yin de ne ga de wo ji ne de yi yi ge de ji ka ka ga ma to mi shi bi ko le jin lo mi shi ka ne shi gu ji ro cha so shi so de ka ne ji ne me do wa ko ka re mi shi ba ji se yo wa
so How can we really then, you know, clear the obstacles, obstructions that obstruct us from understanding the nature of our own mind? Because this really makes us very uncomfortable, and if this is the one that really brings up all those difficulties in our life. For instance, when I only know how to read alphabets, Tibetan alphabet, which is Kakha Kama. Then when I go beyond this alphabet and try to read sentences or even the words, that makes me very uncomfortable, and not being able to read this. So once I have not only just learn how to read alphabet, but when I come to understand how to read words and finally to sentences, then I can just go thoroughly. I can read thoroughly without any difficulties.
mana nga tinti ngi ji tinti ji sen ji ra xin yue si wo tinti ji zha ba du jia qin na kan de jian na la yi na ji le jing wo ra
so one could also ask a question then why is the nature of mind is really completely you know covered by such a thick layers of those obstructions
ma zhe ge bian de qi ran zhe ma zhe zhuo de ge na ni dong bo dong bo se wo se jia jian na ji ini yenda ji ji zha yo ye so de ji yang tōman dēne sēgō chāre, dēne kākō yu tāpā yu sēn tētē tsēnsi jē māre rō, sēn jī sērī lō tōmi tā yu māre.
So that the nature of our mind, the luminosity, is said to be beginningless.
Tā tōmi tā mē bā kāshī jī lā dēne zōng tē rō, sō sō nē pā tsū bī jī jī wāng bōng chā mōng bō jī rīng lā, kō lā sē tā tē yā chā yī chā nē nyū nyū rī pē jī, jī dī shē kē jē yu nā. ko chapa no chue gi le ka chen chue chen ti dada pa de la re pen ma so dada ro ni le ba zi ngo chung yin
right from the beginningless time up until now from the beginningless time this nature of mind is covered by these obstructions and we haven't hardly done anything to really to clear the obstructions and obscurations in fact we have engaged in actions I've done a lot of things that creates more obstructions.
Tintu yin ba chyo kanta ha ko so sen ngal la ngi na roa. Ta nge ta ji lo na ji ji ni yi shi ji sen da de ni ji ga sa chi ba de su ji ma su shang ni de de su ma ji lo yong di. Ta da ba ma de la ga wa chuan de lo shang ma do ko de tin ba de ro men de roa. Ge ji chuo ba che de.
So then how could really say that you know this obstruction your nature of your mind is completely obstructed from the beginning of this time up until now. Then my answer would be, because when I follow the instructions of the higher beings who have taught about the nature of our mind, and not only just I have faith in their instructions, but I also be able to have a certain level of experience, a certain level of conviction that if we put in effort, that we will be able to actually, you know, pierce and discover or just to undo those obstructions. So up until now, that you know why I am unable to really discover my nature of my mind is because the actions that I have taken till now is the action that creates more layers of obstructions. It is therefore we are unable to discover this nature of our mind. Similarly, if someone who has completed the studies of the medicine, and who knows about what is good for yourself and what's not good for yourself, in terms of your foods and so on and so forth, then if you keep engaging, if you keep consuming anything that you consume, is something that really bring about, problems to your own physical body, then this will always create a problem. This will always be a problematic. So you will not be able to really come out yourself or free yourself from the physical problems. Let's take a break here. So what is really right from the beginning when it says the way of purification through the four powers, what it really says is because we are purifying our negativities. Negativity that we have committed. And negative actions that we have committed, although the actions have been completed, your implants the propensities or the imprints of the actions will be planted within the consciousness, what we call the subtlemost consciousness.
So
So what is really obscure our nature of our mind, which is the clear nature of one's mind, or the luminosity, is obscured by two things, that is karma and illusions. As a practitioner, what we really have to think about and put exert an effort to really engage in the practice, if possible, at the time of one's death, at the time of one's death, one should die with high levels of spiritual realizations. If that is not possible, one should at least have no regret of dying, no fear of dying. So it is very important that when one is alive, one's very existence of one's life must be spent in a very peaceful manner. So this again can be done on the basis of practice. So according to the teachers of the past, the great masters of the past, when they, perform the Dharma, the teachings of it, when they teach the Dharma, so they do not teach only by following the text itself, just reading the text and going through the explanation of the text itself. But rather, it alternates, going through the text, just go through a little bit, go through the text a little, and then again let the disciples to really to have some kind of experience, whatever explanation that has been given by the teacher. And they try to focus on their own mind and bring about some kind of experience, letting the, So let's go through the text now. In particular, the way of purification through the four powers. Though you make great efforts not to be defiled by wrongdoing, the faults may arise due to such things as carelessness and the preponderance of the afflictions. If this happens, it is inappropriate to disregard them without caring. So you must try to apply the remedy about which the compassionate teacher spoke. Now, in regard to how to remedy any infractions, do as it is explained in the context of the three vows. If you really look at this particular paragraph, so it's really, you know, this advice is directed towards us. Because though you make a great effort not to be defiled by wrongdoings, the faults may arise due to the such things as carelessness. It is because of our delusions and ignorance. We may not intentionally engage in the negative deeds, but it happens automatically because of not knowing. So when you look at this particular chapter, this particular paragraph, it is really, you know, this advice is really directed towards us. So if someone who knows about what is to be abandoned and what is to be achieved, what is to be accomplished, what is to be adopted, may not really intentionally engage in negative deeds, is that spirit? So then you are not really engaging in active actions intentionally. That means, are you really free from engaging in negative deeds? Not at all. Because of, as we mentioned earlier, because of carelessness, because of this delusions. One may not be engaging in negative deeds intentionally, but because of one's carelessness and ignorance, one engages in negative deeds through body, speech, and mind, continuously. If you look at ourselves and think about when someone expresses a harsh word towards oneself, mm-hmm. one is not be able to even to take one word of harsh words from another person. So then, with this kind of reflections, you then come to understand it is very certain that I'm always engaging in negative deeds. But now what should I do? It is not appropriate just to leave aside and without any, you know, efforts. But what should we really do with the negative deed that we have already committed? Then we need to follow the teachings of the Buddha. Buddha spoke about how we can really purify those negative deeds, the negative deed that we have committed. So then here, when it comes to the restoration of one's own vows. When it comes to the declination of one's own precepts or the vows, There are different kinds of vows, individual liberation vows, Bodhisattva's vows, and the Vajrayana, the vows of the Vajrayana. So with regard to the Vajrayana, the vows, tantric vows in other words, if one has declined the vows, the tantric vows, it can only be restored and revitalized by engaging in the practice of what we call self-initiations, or to receive the empowerments from the teacher. And because you have received these vows in the presence of supportive and supporting mandalas, so you need to engage in the purification practice in the presence of So this individual liberations, the vows of individual liberations, the pratimoksha, you have received this individual liberations in the presence of the Sangha members, and this need to be, if it has undergone declinations, one need to engage in the practice of purification practice in the presence of Sangha members. So then when it comes, to the vows, restoration of the vows of the precepts of the Bodhisattva, the Bodhisattva's vow, it doesn't specifically mention about you should do the practice of purification in presence of certain, you know, images and so on, but rather if one engages in the practice of development of compassion and sense of dearness towards other beings, will then enable one to restore or to revitalize declination of one's Bodhisattva's vow. So however you should remedy sins through the four powers. And sutra, the sutra giving the four teachings. It says, Maitra, the Bodhisattvas, the great heroes, possess these four teachings. Then they will overcome any sins that they have committed and accumulated. What are the fours? So then there are the four eradications, the power of applying remedies, the power of turning away from faults, and the power of the foundations. So this four, we really need to understand those four remedies, the practice of four four purifications. The first is a power of eradications. So what this really entails, what it really suggests, it is suggesting one to actually to eradicate whatever the negative actions that one had committed in the past.
Nyingpo kyu du shi bito se na, jida nga zu Nyingpo se na, tete te yi kate lo kogoro ro. Me yi kate le chu Nyingpo, nga zu chadang se se na ro, Nyingpo se teni che lo kogoro ro.
So the power of applying remedies is the next, which is also the power of applying actual antidotes. Literally, translation, which like in order to extinguish the fire, we need a water. The water will be the remedy for fires, and heat and cold. The cold is the coldness is the remedy towards the heat and so forth.
Mm-hmm. 진정이 예보시려서는 이 예 진정 장축이 있어야 되세요, 그러와. 예보 이쯤이 이제 카드에도 거고 그러와.
So we really need to understand the remedy, the actual remedy, the direct remedy or direct antidotes to each of those negative deeds or negativities. For instance, what is the actual antidotes or the direct antidotes of self-grasping mind, which is wisdom realizing emptiness or the wisdom realizing selflessness? Wisdom that understands the selflessness is the direct antidote towards the self-grasping mind. And self-cherishing mind, the antidote towards self-cherishing mind is the practice of compassion and practice of bodhicitta. So, when it comes to the second power, the power of applying remedies, is what it really suggests here is to really challenge oneself, to challenge that negative deeds, whatever the negative deeds that one has committed.
The
meaning will come later when we go through the text, but if you go through a little explanation that give you a brief explanation of the third antidote, the practice of purification, that it is committing not to engage in such actions in the future. In other words, you are making a pledge that you will never make such engage in such misdeeds in the future. The fourth one is the power of foundations. It is also translated in some texts in English by the power of reliance, because there is again one kind of practice of purification that can be done by relying upon certain object of refuge and so on. So we'll go through this, the detailed meaning later, but this is just a brief explanation of what the four practice of four application of antidote means. So when someone asks them, what can we really do to purify our negativity, then we should have this answer ready. The practice of four powerful antidotes. So then it says, you will definitely experience the result of karma that you have done and accumulated. And since the four powers can destroy this kind of karma before it starts to take effect, it goes without saying that the four powers can destroy karma whose result is definite. indefinite, sorry.
Matsu tenu rwa, chidan lele shesa tsambi lele, shesa ma tsambi lele sada lagu rwa. Shesa tsambi lele na, njibu nyongwa ngenbi lele, ten kibi lele jire rwa. Tendu ki ten kibi ki lele chi ina yang, nipo togi ten suna mepo zo tugu yana, jenda dan kecha shiba ma rwa asunga rwa.
So when it comes to the accumulation of karma, negative karma, we have negative karma that is completed both execution of actions and accumulated accumulation of negative karma and so forth. If one is completed these two, execution of actions and accumulation of the negative karma, then its result is certain. However, even though that result is completely, the cause is completely created and it is ready to give rise to its result, if you're able to really engage in the practice of four purifications, and it can be eradicated. So then, if such a intense karma can be eradicated, then there's no question of not being able to eradicate the other minor negative karma that we have committed.
Then I just want to ask you something, Roa. That is just a question, Roa. Because just a question.
所以，他感觉到我自己接了，那你这不就熊年把鸡蛋蛋先看清楚呢？可能给越来越慢了，是吧？天气不热，是吧？所以，So for instance, if there's a certain field or the corn field, in other words, we take a specific example. For after a month, it is certain to have its result after a month. It is completely sudden. So everybody is sudden that everybody have a conviction of getting a result out of that particular field after 1 month.
Then, 단단히 차는 게 바래다 로봇이 진용을 쓰여지는 말어. 로봇이 진지기 매포서 했던 여러다.
Although it is certain that we will get a result from that field after 1 month, it is certain. But it's also a possibility. There's also a possibility. There might be a certain, advantageous, unfavorable condition may arise. It could be destroyed by storm or the flood, and because of this, imbalances of the elements.
단단히 차는 것 같아요.
So at this point, if you look at our negative deeds, although the negative deeds is completed, we already committed the cause, it is certain to give rise to its fruition. Yet at the same time, if you become aware and engage in the practice of four purifications that we talked about earlier, then it can be eradicated. The result will be prevented. So we are, in a sense, at this point, we kind of, most of the time, we remain very careless. We are not aware of we have committed negative deeds, nor we are aware of we have not committed any negative deeds. We're kind of spending most of our life in time in a very careless manner. So, we, don't really remember that we have really engaged in any negative deeds intentionally. But if you really look at very carefully and reflect very carefully, there are many negative deeds that we have committed due to carelessness. So, because we never have been able to protect ourselves, the doors of negative deeds. we haven't been able to really be aware of being protective of the doors of the negative deeds. So it is, if those doors are remain unprotected and doors have been open for thousands of years, you know, tens of thousands of years, then it is not possible to not enter in the negative deeds inside the door. So, for instance, if you look at it this time, although we know a little bit about what is to be abandoned and what is to be accomplished, what is to be adopted, such as, you know, adopting virtuous deeds and abandoning negative deeds and so on. Yet at the same time, we commit those negative deeds, either physically, mentally, or verbally. So if you really look at ourselves and really, draw a conclusion, it is appropriate for us to really draw a conclusion that we have really committed a tremendous amount of negative deeds in the past.
So
according to the instructions or the teachings of the great masters of the past, it says when we really look at the negative deed that we have committed, it is really completed and very authentic, just like an object or the that we could find in a very rich family's house, something that is very useful. So this is how we have really committed when you look at the negative deeds. When it comes to the positive deeds or the virtuous deed, it is analogous to an object that belongs to a very poor family. It's not very useful. It has not much, you know, power and so on. So we'll leave here today here with this.
So,
as we mentioned at the beginning of our teachings, that two important steps that is very important to receiving teachings in the beginning, cultivating appropriate motivations, at the end is dedications. So now we are dedicating here the merits that we have committed here, accumulated here. Just think about that. Right from the beginning of his time up until now, It is because of this ignorance. I haven't been able to discover myself that I possess such a precious jewel within my mind, within my continuum. It is because of that I have not been able to achieve lasting happiness, but always drift of happiness and running after the sufferings continuously. So now, from today onwards, having understood the possessing of this wonderful jewel within oneself, I must make good use of it, and I will definitely make myself put in effort to really to discover this jewel that is within my continuum, and I will dedicate whatever the merits and virtues that I have accumulated today towards the state of enlightenment of self and all other beings, and I will dedicate all my merits by letting my mind influenced by the teachings of the Dharma.
Tudjan nagyjét adott rozsécsén,
Thank you.